the end of last year is probably the starting point to answer your question. So at the end of last year, Fed Chairman Powell made a bit of a surprise announcement, which really sounded quite dovish to the markets. And I think a lot of people were caught off guard there. They had expected higher for longer interest rates. Reading between the lines of what he said, it suddenly went from really no perhaps interest rate cuts, or just one or two at the back end of the year, to maybe as many as seven during the course of 2024. So that really set markets off kind of mid-November through end of the year on a bit of a tear. And then I think a number of things happened at the beginning of 2024, literally kind of the first week. Of course, one of the awful things was what's been going on in the Middle East, which just compounded what was going on perhaps already in Eastern Europe. And suddenly the sort of geopolitical risk landscape changed a bit. If you add on to that the narrative of, let's say, the fear of contagion around the Middle East, and in particular attacks on the Red Sea shipping through the Suez Canal, suddenly you're adding 19, 20 days to a voyage. You're increasing a lot the freight that is necessary to get goods from A to B. And suddenly that inflation that looked like it was being beaten suddenly comes back into quite sharp relief. As that conflict in the Middle East escalates, there's fear that it could go from the, if you like, the west coast of the Gulf, the Red Sea, into the Straits of Hormuz, where an awful lot of the world's oil is supplied from. That's just literally a narrow 12-mile strip across. And if that happens, then, of course, the price of oil is going to potentially rise very dramatically from here. So I think all of that sort of Goldilocks soft landing narrative at the end of last year has been disrupted, perhaps not by the ordinary course of events, but these sudden geopolitical risks that have increased quite dramatically. And I think there's two competing schools of thought here, really based on how much that conflict is going to escalate from here. I think the purpose of any stock exchange is to raise capital for companies to grow. So the answer to your question is simply how do you make the FTSE more attractive for people to raise money is to perhaps make the listing rules as accommodating as possible, to make any taxes in that environment as business friendly as possible, and to attract as many investors as you can to the UK and to the City of London in particular. So the composition of the FTSE itself, it's interesting, it's really dominated by oil, mining, and consumers and pharmaceuticals. These are what we sort of typically refer to, perhaps rather lazily, as value stocks. If you look at what happened in America last year versus what happened on the FTSE, the S&P was up 24%, but largely driven really by seven companies. And the other 493 actually didn't really outperform the FTSE by very much. So if there was to be a rotation out of these so-called growth stocks back into value, where suddenly things like dividend yield becomes more important and stability of earnings becomes more important, then the FTSE, without really doing anything at all, might become a little bit more loved than perhaps it was last year. So there's really two things. One is what is the sort of external market sentiment towards value versus growth. The second is, you know, can you make the FTSE more attractive to companies to raise money from? And also, perhaps, if there was more technology in the FTSE 100, then you would actually get a bit of exposure to those so-called growth stocks that have powered the S&P. I mean, the thing about options that I think is really fundamental to answering your question is to understand that when you buy an underlying security or an underlying asset, you're buying something that is really going to go either up, down, or sideways. But it is what we call a flat price trade. And it's just whether the market is going to move in that particular stock, in which particular direction. The interesting thing about that, of course, is that the old saying of markets can remain irrational a lot longer than you can remain liquid is so true. So you could have a perfectly reasonable postulation about a particular stock and the value of that stock, and yet sentiment in that particular segment is negative. And you find that despite all of these promises of great earnings and what looks like a rosy future can go sideways or downwards for no obvious reason related to that individual stock itself. When you trade options, it's about much more than just flat price movements, because there are two very large components to the price of an option other than just the flat price, specifically volatility. And the more volatile the underlying asset is, then the more volatility that is going to be priced into the option, the greater the likelihood of it being in the money, at the money, out the money, because it's going up and down quite rapidly. So you pay effectively a premium for volatility. The more volatile it is, the more your option is worth. So you could have a situation where the underlying stock on the option is going down, but because it's so volatile, the value of the long option position is actually going up when the underlying stock is going down, simply as a function of the volatility. And of course, the other thing is time. So with a stock, you can buy and hold for 20 years, and it obviously, if nothing happens to it, then it's just going to carry on. If there's no corporate action or bankruptcy or takeover or whatever, it just carries on going. Whereas by definition, an option or a future for that matter, any derivative, is a time-specific instrument. And the nearer you get to the expiry of that time-specific instrument, the less money it's worth. So it starts out, if you buy a long-dated option, the time erosion is rather marginal each day. If you buy a two-year forward option, one day doesn't make a huge amount of difference. But of course, if it's only got a matter of days or even hours to expiry, then maybe an awful lot has got to happen before that option could expire in or at the money. And therefore, the erosion is very significant. So we tend to think of it at the sort of most basic level as flat price, time, and volatility are the three main components. There are plenty of other Greeks as we talk about them as well. Yeah, it's interesting. After the global financial crisis, derivatives generally perhaps all got tarred with the same brush. In 2002, Warren Buffett had talked about a lot of these securitized derivatives as being weapons of financial mass destruction, and they definitely sort of went out of favor. You then had a massive injection of central bank liquidity, and all markets pretty much went bottom left, top right for about sort of 12, 13 years. It was pretty much a one-way street up until really COVID struck. So that suddenly put the brakes on absolutely everything. And people realized that, you know, there are still, in whatever benign situation you're in, major bumps in the road that can seriously disrupt a, if you like, a long-term investment strategy. So suddenly then, I think with that volatility that came around COVID, options came back into more, perhaps sharper relief. And of course, since then, there's, instead of quantitative easing, been quantitative tightening. The investment scenario has changed very dramatically in the last 18 months, from money basically being pretty much free to money costing, you know, sort of 5.5% plus whatever premium banks had on top of that. So a very dramatic change in a very short period of time. And what happens if you are basically looking after a core store of wealth? Typically, even the most conservative portfolio would be 60% equities, 40% bonds. I think in the wake of the global financial crisis and all of the bank loosening and interest rates coming down, it would have probably been more 80 or even 85% equities. The great thing about being long of equities is that you get a dividend income from those equities. You may have a corporate action or a nice surprise. You may have, if you sell them to rotate perhaps into cash, you may crystallize capital gains and have to pay tax on things that you'd rather not. But of course, the main thing is if you do rotate out of equities and into cash or bonds, the chances are, particularly as a private investor, you're going to miss that bounce. And that's probably the most expensive cost of all is people tend to sell as markets are coming down because they're rather afraid of what's going to happen next. And then they wait to see the bull trend resume, by which stage they probably missed the first 15, 20% of the rally. So what we've seen recently in terms of options trading is people that net-net want to stay well invested in equities, particularly if there's an inflationary risk, because a share of a tangible asset, tangible goods, hard assets is a good thing to own. So what people tend to do is either buy puts or put spreads as a, literally like an insurance for your car. You don't mind if they expire worthless, but if there is a significant move to the downside, you've got leverage protection. So for not very much capital, you can get sort of 3-4x return if there is a sharp market move to the downside. We also saw quite a lot when interest rates were very, very low of people thinking, where else can they get income from? And if you own a core portfolio of stocks, some people were quite happy to take profit on those stocks if they went up by more than a certain amount, perhaps within a certain period of time. You'd be quite happy to take a 5% profit in 3 months if that was available to you. So why not grant an option, what we call a covered call? So you're going to get the income from selling that call. If the stock goes up, then you're going to have to deliver your stock against that expiring option. But if it doesn't go up and just stays the same, then you get to keep the income. So covered calls, income generation. We also see when things aren't just bottom left, top right, but when they're a bit more volatile, people looking to trade tactically. So you still want to hold those core stocks, let's say the Fab 7, if you're lucky enough to own Nvidia or Google or one of those tech companies. They're coming into their quarterly results. You don't really know what's going to happen, but you might like to put a short-term option strategy around that. For instance, you could put a straddle or a strangle around it. So even if it goes up 10 or 15% or down 10 or 15% in reaction to a particular piece of news, you could actually profit from either move as long as there's a move either way. Similarly, if you didn't think there was going to be a move, you could sell those strategies rather than buy them. And then the other thing we see is for portfolio entry and exit, so position entry and exit. If I wanted to buy a stock at 5% cheaper than it's currently trading, then I might grant a put option at a sort of out of the money put option. If it hits me, then I will have to take up that stock, but I'm happy to do so. If not, again, I'll just keep the income that I got. So rather than a good until cancelled order, I can actually just sell a put and get paid to wait for it to come to me. If it doesn't come to me, I don't mind because I've got the income. One of the USPs of OptionsDesk is, I suppose if it's unique, because maybe I'm only allowed one thing, but it's the word desk. So what's happened now, particularly during COVID, was this massive explosion in platform trading and almost the gamification of investing. And what's happened now is that with technology and the number of people getting into this, it's almost impossible to keep up or service that kind of flow with human beings. So everything comes onto an app, everything goes into a technology solution, chatbots and AI assistance. And that's fine for, perhaps small trades and things that aren't really of great importance to you from an overall wealth perspective. But if you're serious about trading and managing risk associated with perhaps a rather larger portfolio that you want to protect, you do want to talk to human beings. You do want to talk to people whose expertise you can tap into. And one of the key areas that we pride ourselves in, to answer your question, I think the actual USP, when you trade leveraged derivatives, financial instruments, there are two things that you want to be aware of. One is the margin call and understanding what happens if that position moves against you from a cash flow perspective, and particularly if you're granting options, how you can manage your exposure to those margin calls by moving positions that you have perhaps further down the board or further away from the money or into the money, obviously depending if you're buying or selling those options. So margin management, I would say, is one area of real expertise. The other thing that we pride ourselves on is not giving you directional advice and telling you this share or that share is going to go up or down. But if you as a client have a strong view of what you think is going to happen and you want to express that with options, what we are very good at is telling you where on the forward curve, where on that vol surface represents the best value in terms of combination of perhaps time and volatility and price point to get you that kind of exposure that you want with that kind of risk profile and margin exposure that is appropriate for the trade that you're putting on. And I think that's really the secret sauce. Options are very complex, as you said, and I've been trading them for about 35 years, but actually not in the equity space necessarily, more across the commodity space. But understanding how options can be used as part of a integrated whole, I think for me is the real thing. And there are now not very many companies that allow you to even place orders to trade options. So it used to be pre-global financial crisis. The city had many, many houses that you could go to as wealth management sort of professionals, and you could express what it was that you wanted to do in a combination of underlying cash products, maybe some funds, maybe some options. And then I think post-financial crisis, the regulatory burden of talking about options to retail investors became much higher risk, if you like, because the financial ombudsman, not only in this country but across Europe, was asking the question. They weren't telling you the answer, but they were asking the question of, are these instruments appropriate for everybody? And if they're not appropriate, what are you doing about it? Obviously, that really culminated in the introduction of the consumer duty in the UK at the end of July 2023. Where you've gone from a regulatory conduct regime that made you treat your clients fairly, and you had to be able to demonstrate how you went about treating your clients fairly. You now have a regulation, a law, that says you must ensure your client has a good outcome. So it's gone from fair to good, and it's gone from sort of conduct to law. So the bar has gone up very, very considerably. So unless your business is built around the ability to really talk to clients, to understand from them what it is that they're looking at, to understand what their needs are and what their personal circumstances are, you know, these instruments aren't as appropriate necessarily as perhaps they were in the past. And of course, a large part of the consumer duty is evidencing that they are appropriate. In other words, through the conversations that you've had, through the contracts that you ask them to sign and how clearly they're signposted, all of these things. So what you've seen is a lot of people in options pulling out of that business because the regulatory burden is so high, which I think is a terrible shame, because they have been around for many, many years as a means to hedge, to protect, to help smooth volatility, to help manage exposures. And that's kind of been taken away for many people because they're deemed to be inappropriate, or perhaps too much hassle, if you like, from the provider to be able to service. And as a result, you literally just have that flat price exposure where you're either in or out. And it's quite binary. So we saw a really big opportunity to build a business with all the technology investment going into the fulfillment of that obligation to communicate clearly with our clients, to evidence the steps that we've taken, to follow up with them to make sure that they're getting a good outcome, and to be able to provide that evidence to the regulator if they come and ask for it. And so when you're building a business really from the ground up, and you're making it fit for that purpose, it's much easier to do that than it is to retrofit something that's already there with perhaps a huge number of different interests.